Hello there. My name's Sometimes Haverant. I play Elskull Sunlight, mostly in the same stage 4 vampire. During my adventures with the family of Rosas, I've learned a lot about how to make playing as a vampire enjoyable. Today, I'd like to share some tips and tricks I've gathered along the way. Let's start with how it can begin. Elizabeth here ran into a blood fiend during a midnight outing and got bit. Her character window now shows that she's infected with Noxophilic Sanguivoria, a disease that can turn you into a full-blown vampire. If you find yourself lucky enough to carry said disease, you have three choices. First, you can visit Prelate Sabinus at some mages' guilds and all rededication shrines. He can cure the disease for you. Second, you can ignore it. The contagion itself is harmless. It won't affect you in any way until you choose to act upon it. This brings us to the third choice. After being infected, a vampire will approach you as you enter Evermore, Rollcar, or Riften. Vorondil will start a conversation with you, explaining what happened. Eventually, he will lead you to the Blood Matron's crypt, where you will surrender to the curse of vampirism. Unlocking the vampire skill line tempts you to feed on enemies. I would advise against this though until you are better prepared. Feeding advances your vampire stage. On stage 1, everything is nice and easy. Penalties start to get discouraging on stage 3, and on stage 4, things get really tricky. Your health will not regenerate, you're vulnerable to fire, your abilities cost more, and merchants won't do business with you. Vampire stage goes down with time. It takes only 4 real-life hours to get back to stage 3. If you're like me, you're already on stage 4 and need a quick solution. Here it is. There are 2 provisioning recipes in the game that help both lower and raise vampire stage. They are called Purifying Bloody Mara and Corrupting Bloody Mara. They're both relatively rare and challenging to farm out, but always available at guild vendors. The going price is around 5,000 to 10,000 pieces of gold, so do shop around to find the best deals. Preparing the drinks requires your character to master the provisioning skill line. Mine hasn't, so let's change tunes. That's better. After reading the recipes, you'll be able to create both drinks at any cooking station. Purifying Bloody Mara reduces your vampire stage by 1. Each time you drink 1, vampire stage drops. This is really convenient, especially when you're still a small one. Just knock back a potion and merchants will be happy to trade with you. You'll also get some health recovery back. To return to vampire stage 4, you can go and feed on enemies. Each time you eat, your stage increases. There is also a faster way for this. Consuming a single serving of Corrupting Bloody Mara will take you to Vampire Stage 4 in the blink of an eye. I personally prefer feeding. To feed on an innocent enemy, sneak up behind them and activate the ability. This will trigger a feeding animation and push you 1 stage further. Advancing in the vampire skill line happens in the ordinary way, by gathering experience. Abilities are unlocked through experience gained and morphed in the usual manner. Many vampire abilities are also criminal abilities. Using these in public will give you a hefty bounty and cause guards to attack you. The easiest way to deal with this is to follow the basic laws of Tamriel. Don't attack anyone in a city. Outside cities, no one truly cares. I'd like to point out 1 ability in the vampire skill line that's very different from anything else in the game. Mesmerize is meant not only to slow down enemies, but also to charm NPCs. Using this on merchants and bankers will force them to do business with you, even when you're a stage 4 vampire. I'd recommend unlocking Mesmerize before pushing your vampire to stage 4. It makes life a lot easier. Stage 4 comes with various penalties, increased fire damage being one of them. The easiest way to get around this is to play as a Dunmer. Dark Elf racial passives grant quite a bit of flame resistance. Other races may benefit from jewelry enchanted with flame resistance. This might not prove that effective though. Another way to help boost flame resistance is through champion points. In Warfare, you'll find the Staving Death constellation. This cluster of stars offers bonuses to damage resistance. The elemental Aegis reduces the amount of damage taken from magical attacks. Placing champion points on this one should boost flame resistance. Another penalty increases the cost of regular abilities. In other words, vampires require more magicka or stamina to use their abilities. Some races have increased base attributes. Altmer, Breton, and Dunmer have more magicka than other races, whereas Bosmer, Khajiit, and Redguards restore stamina faster. Choosing the best race isn't always possible, though. It might be better to use glyphs, potions, and foods to get buffs to stamina or magicka recovery. Looking into sets that grant buffs to your favored attributes is also a good idea. I usually go with a combo of both. My food buffs add a boost to all three attributes, and armor and jewelry enchantments help with magicka or stamina recovery. Some sets, like Armor of the Seducer, grant a lessened magicka cost. Sets that grant a lessened stamina cost are more challenging to find. For a stamina build, I would rely on glyphs, especially on weapons. Glyph of Absorb Stamina allows you to deal physical damage while restoring stamina. Penalties regarding higher ability cost and vulnerability to fire are pretty easy to go around. Health, however, is another thing. A stage 4 vampire's health does not regenerate. Where a normal character's health creeps up on its own, a vampire's health goes down and stays there. Luckily, healing abilities still work. One option is to group up with a healer. This way, you'll have someone watching your back. You can also get a companion and turn them into a healer. There are quite a few healer builds out there for Miri. Having your own personal healer follow you is a very good option. Unless you really don't want a companion. When adventuring solo, you'll need to be your own healer. Healing potions are an easy way to top up the health bar, but all potions have a cooldown. Through the Clever Alchemist set and certain glyphs, you should be able to take the cooldown to 21 seconds, but relying on potions alone isn't the easiest way to stay alive. Abilities have all kinds of fun self-healing perks that help keep your health up in a more passive way. If you play a Sorc, Critical Surge is an easy way to restore health. This adds to weapon damage and allows each critical strike to restore missing health. This is truly a must for vampire sorcs. Combat pets also restore health along with dark exchange and absorption field. I often rely on a combination of surge and entropy. Together, these abilities make my vampire sorcs very difficult to kill. Templars have a wide selection of healing abilities to choose from. This might be the easiest class to play as a stage 4 vampire, but it is also law-breaking. For an immersion build, I would hesitate picking a Templar. Nightblades also have various self-healing abilities. They're able to siphon the life force of living enemies during combat. This makes Nightblades excellent vampires. Mark Target is my favorite from this class, along with Swallow Soul. As many abilities in this class have to do with stealing life, I feel that Nightblade vamps are the best for immersion. Necromancers have an entire skill line dedicated to healing abilities. I've tested out many of these with my vampires, and I prefer Spirit Guardian and Mortal Coil over others. These are both fun and effective. Weapons also have healing abilities. Restoration Staff is quite obvious, but you can also find some in two-handed and bow skill lines. When creating a stage 4 vampire, choosing abilities that come with a side of self-healing makes life, or undeath, a lot easier. Still, playing as a vampire is never effortless. You'll need to deal with hatred and fear, penalties cruel and unusual, being cursed, corrupted. You might wonder why I keep returning to vampirism time and time again. Why I subject my characters to such suffering. Perhaps it's the challenge, perhaps the beauty of lore. Vampires are like no other creatures. Seductive monsters clad in shadows, feeding on the blood of the living to hang on to a life that is no longer real. Humans have held the myth of vampires alive for centuries. Through Carmilla, Dracula, Lestat, Elizabeth, even the vampires in Elder Scrolls Online. Perhaps it is only the mystery that fascinates me. I guess I'll ponder on that in my coffin tonight. I hope you've enjoyed this video. Next time, I thought I might tell you a story. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you all later. Ciao!